webinar technicalities. So I believe that by now everyone is comfortably sitting in your office chair, or perhaps in your sofa at home, or who knows, maybe even in bed. So in any case, the important is that you are all able to hear us and to see the presentations. There is a chat here, so if you have any trouble, please let us know and we'll do our best to sort out the technicalities. We are very happy of the enormous response that we have received. There's been almost more than 70 people registering from different organizations and backgrounds. So it's really great to know that there is so much interest for this topic that we believe is so critical today. So also for you to know that this webinar is being recorded. So this will be shared afterwards. So please do share it with your colleagues or people interested that you know could not make it to this event today. We have an excellent panel of speakers, and I'm very happy that they made the time, very grateful that they made the time to share the knowledge on this topic of air pollution from waste disposal today. We know this issue of air pollution has increasingly gained traction in the global environmental agenda, given the very severe negative impacts on public health and the environment and the sustainability agenda. And many of these impacts have been addressed or not by the EU policies. And this is precisely what we will explore today, looking specifically at the contribution to air pollution from waste disposal activities, with particular attention to waste-to-energy incinerators. So the panel today includes the Professor Vyvyan Howard, well-known expert on air pollution from University of Ulster, who will tell us about the contribution of waste-to-energy incinerators to air pollution and public health, specifically looking at nanoparticles. We will also have the presentation from Sergio Sastre from environmental consultancy ENT and author of the report Air Pollution from Waste Disposal Not for Public Breath that we published last year, who will give us an overview of the overall EU policy framework and will highlight some case studies that show the main challenges that we found in the waste sector in relation to air pollution. We also are happy to present Kristen Ågren from the Air and Climate Secretariat that will look more specifically at the latest directive that it's been approved last summer. Well, there's an initial agreement, this directive, and Kristen will tell us all about it. It's the National Ceiling Emissions Directive that has set up national targets for particular emissions, including PM2.5, which are particularly important as the waste-to-energy incinerators are a major source of this kind of pollution. So Krister will talk about the new elements in this directive and what impact they can have in the waste sector. And last but not least, Aliki, Kriekouki will talk about the best available techniques, the reference documents, BREF, referring to the waste-to-energy incineration that is currently being reviewed, and telling us what kind of opportunities we can find in there for further regulation. I will ask speakers to stick to presentations of no longer than 15-20 minutes, and I will ask participants to hold on your questions directly for the speakers until the end of the event, and then we will have time for questions that you can write in your chat, and then we will give the floor to speakers to respond to your questions. So without further delay, I think, okay, great. So the first speaker is gonna be Professor Vyvyan Howard. Thank you so much for being with us today. The floor is yours.
I've got to check Vyvyan's might be having a bit of problems with his voice.
Okay, we're just helping Vyvyan to navigate the software. Just thank you everyone for your patience and collaboration. Okay, so we'll need a bit of time to check in with Vyvyan. So we'll start with Sergio Sastre. Sergio, are you ready?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
Can everybody hear me from the chat? Yeah, cool. So, thank you. I see you're listening. Okay, so as Marielle said, I'm the author of the report Evolution from Gas Disposal, published 1 year ago, if I remember well, in November 2015. And the first thing I want to say is just to notice that the information contained in this presentation refers to the report with the same name of this webinar, that this report was commissioned by Zero Waste Europe to Fundación End in 2015, and therefore perhaps I have tried to update everything I could in these days, but it was a good bunch of information, so perhaps some data and legal references might be outdated by now. So let me know by the end of the presentation if some of these, particularly the other speakers, if they see something that is outdated, please. As noted. Okay, the content is going to be brief, hopefully. I would like to give an overview of the EU legal framework on incineration and co-incineration in waste, co-incineration of waste. This report was made based on some case studies, but I have tried to rearrange the presentation in order to give first the overview on the legal framework, and then talk a little bit about what strategies we found in the EU legal framework and some of the points stemming from this study. And I will introduce, if I have time, the examples from the case study. Anyway, you can find the report, as Mariela is saying in the chat, right in the link you have available there. So starting with the EU legal framework, we divided it into two big groups. The group of regulation on emissions, understood as pollution coming from industrial processes, like the output of industrial processes, and measured at the emission points. It is fabric, industrial facilities, chimneys, cars also. On the other hand, you have regulation on emission. It is pollution as it is received by society, by citizens. And it is typically measured in open air conditions, such as urban areas, for example. So with this big framework, we can group the main regulation in the EU as regulation on emission, as referred to ambient air quality. And you have two main pieces of legislation, which are Ambient Air Quality Directive, the 2008 directive, and another piece, more specific, related to arsenic, cadmium, mercury, nickel, and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. On the emission side, we have the Industrial Emissions Directive and the aforementioned National Emission Ceilings Directive, which I guess there is another fellow that is going to be talking about this, so I will pass this directive. And even if it's not strictly strictly related to waste incineration, you have to confine also some legislation on emissions from transport, like the directive you can see listed in the right box, referred to automotive fuel quality and the Marine Pollution Convention, the MAPOL, among others, which are not directly relevant to this chat. So a couple of notes is, as I said, Kristen Ågren will be speaking of the neck, so I will pass this over. And I guess it has been under revision, so all the details will be explained by my fellows. Okay, regarding emissions, the main thing is Directive 2010/75 EU on industrial emissions, which regulates waste incinerators and other facilities. Among these, those facilities where coal incineration is carried out. Okay, this piece of legislation was put in place in 2010, but it wasn't until 2014 that it substituted the previous legislation in place that was directed from 2008 on integrated pollution prevention and control, and the Directive 2076 EC on waste incineration. This is relevant to be said because in the case studies we addressed in this report, by the time frames we were studying, were under this this legislation was in place during this period. So it was relevant to the case studies, but maybe not so relevant for the coming years. Oh, somebody lost his or her audio. Is everything okay? Well, I will continue. Okay. As you can see, this directive repealed and substituted another legislation previously in place regarding pollution in industrial facilities, waste incineration plants, and other particular pollutants like organic solvents and titanium, for example. I have copied here some of the main pollutants as they are regulated in the directive. So you can find here some of the values for different time ranges, as for example here are the daily averages for waste incineration plants. You can find total dust, hydrogen chloride, fluoride, sulfur dioxide, etc. Then you have the half hourly average. This is relevant because then you have to take different measures from facilities and plants in order to compare if they have emitted more or over or above this value. So, well, these are the reference values you can find in the regulation. This is, for example, for sampling period about minimum 30 minutes and maximum 8 hours. As the time ranges diminish, you will find that their load concentrations are a little bit higher. So this is like the main information on what is allowed to be emitting from industrial plants, from incineration and co-incineration plants. This is, for example, for several of the case studies we addressed for cement kilns, co-incineration waste. Here are the values that are the reference for saying if they are surpassing or not the legal values. On the other hand, we have the Directive 2008/50 EC on air quality and cleaner air, which at the same time is compiling some of the previous, well, compiling and giving coherence to some of the previous legislation on the field, as referred to, well, ambient air quality assessment, some limit values for sulfur dioxide and nitrogen dioxide, or particulate matter and lead in ambient air. So this framework did like a compilation of all these previous legal regulation and converted it into a new one, as expressed in the table you have here, where you can find type of pollutants, the type of measurements measured in different time ranges, and the concentration allowed. This is what is measured in ambient air. It means that it can be measured in a neighborhood or any other urban area, in a parking or on the roof of a building, for example. And Directive 2004/107 EC, which is related to other different arsenic, cadmium, other different pollutants, which is like a complement to this regulation. Okay, here are the main findings of the report regarding this legislation. For example, for industrial emissions, we found that even if there is a set of limits, these limits can be surpassed under several conditions, like mainly based on economic criteria, when they have disproportionately higher costs compared to the benefits that you find, well, you can surpass these levels. Also, the types of other ways of surpassing this is, as Article 59.2 foresees, when it's not technically and economically feasible, the competent authority can, by allow emissions to exceed this value set in the tables I showed you before. So, moreover, the monitoring is carried out and reported by the companies undertaking incineration. So, the filters and the continuous monitoring systems are currently paid and managed by the cement plants and incinerators, which in reality makes it really difficult to find averages. No, we couldn't find any company reporting against themselves that they had surpassed the value. So, well, we didn't find any breach on the emission side. What we found, seeming from the case studies, was that the process, there is a process of public consultations which is mandatory to the when incineration and co-incineration is going to be carried out, and it requires a permit, and the issuing of these permits has resulted into a source of conflict in different places of Europe. According to the case study, this is one of the main, well, conflictive points, because it tends not to be so transparent, and well, the population complains, and it has led to several of the incineration plants in Europe to be closed. Then we have found that by the emission side, the values measured from urban areas, for example, they are different from those recommended by the World Health Organization. And here's the table in which we compared what is recommended as by the World Health Organization and what is within the EU regulation. And we found several differences, which implies that at some point the European Union is assuming a certain risk by permitting this higher concentration of several pollutants in ambient air. So we are assuming that, well, there is a higher risk for life expectancy in Europe as compared to the values recommended by the World Health Organization. This is the other part of the table for arsenium, cadmium, nickel, and polycyclic hydrocarbons. Apart from this difference between the World Health Organization and the EU standards, we found that there was a lack of reference values in the directive for some pollutants, and that how you measure these concentrations in ambient air has to be made under several conditions, and these conditions allow for an additional range of acceptable uncertainty that in practice allow for a higher actual concentration of pollutants. So instead of applying perhaps a precautionary principle, this is the opposite situation, in which regulation allows for higher levels of, apart from the World Health Organization, higher levels than required in the EU legislation. So the Air Quality Directive assumes several deviations from the World Health Organization's organization recommendations, which in turn implies assuming a certain risk to health, which is measured as the probability of premature death. Moreover, we found that there was room for further developing and prioritizing the higher tiers of the waste hierarchy. The waste hierarchy, I mean, I guess everybody's might be familiar in this room with this, with the waste hierarchy as posed by the European Commission. It has been demonstrated that high levels of separate collection and recycling, which is around 75% in around Europe, is achievable. I mean, it's real, it's happening. In this case, incineration would not be required to comply with the directive on landfill and the directive on municipal waste. So, I mean, there are other ways, there are desktop-based solutions to deal with waste apart from incineration, which are not being explored so far. So, To some extent, fostering incineration means that the potential contribution of waste management to a transition towards a low carbon economy was being missed. Another thing we found was perhaps more in the political economy side of the issue, was that co-incineration had a triple dividend, for example, in Spain. Incinerators and co-incinerators, cement plants, get paid for incinerating waste. In Spain, it was 10 euros per ton, in the case of Lafarge Moncada, for example. And this is the first way they are having a dividend. The second one was they were saving the corresponding quantity of fossil fuel substituted by waste, and therefore the costs. They can trade emission permits corresponding to those fossil fuel savings, some of which were assigned to these facilities at no cost. So in practice, this implied that taxpayers were effectively supporting waste incineration, and they had not been asked to, the associated allocation of health and environmental risk. So this was one of the, I guess, one of the main insights of the co-incineration cases. And a little bit of background on the cases we addressed. This one on Lafarge Moncada, which is in Barcelona, is a cement plant co-incinerating waste. This is the hourly average for particles. We found that even if they were below the EU regulation requirements, they were well over the World Health Organization recommendations. So this is a typical case of uncertainty. We are assuming that we are over the value, so we are allocating a risk of health risk to this population by permitting these levels that are legal, but well, it implies something else. And here are the concentrations, which are in the middle of the between the recommendation of the World Health Organization and the EU, which is 30 milligrams per normal square meter. The next case was in Slovenia. I cannot pronounce this place, I'm sorry, but it's a lot of consonants together. I'm in Spanish. It's in Slovenia, and it was a case in which a population complained. It was related to incineration, and it was around how the permits had been issued and how the lack of transparency led to the closure of this facility. We address also cases in Bavaria, in Germany, in which we could register all the number of exceedances in limit values in 2011, for example, and there was a lot of them. So the argument of the point in favor of waste incineration as a safe technology was clearly was debated in this case study. Specifically, because there was a lot of exceedances in limit values, even if all the technical measures were implemented. And the Gable, for example, in the UK, had the same situation, and it was closed down. And during the operational period of this incinerator, we could register, like, well, you can see here the list, 45 noise complaints, the TA bypass tax activation, etc., etc. There was a shutdown that intended to solve some of this problem, but in the second period they registered these additional incidents, and in the third time it was started, it has again 6 dioxin limit values breaches in 2012 and a faulty temperature controllers cultural outburst, which finally shut down the facility. So some conclusion. Oh, there's something trying to ask. Well, let's address it later. The conclusions we found were that the current design of the EU legal framework allows for emission limit values that face an unavoidable allocation of health and environmental risk to those citizens living nearby incineration and co-incineration activities. The second was that all although emission limit values were regulated, there was significant space for more stringent emission and emission values linked to health and environmental risk criteria, for example, based on the World Health Organization guidelines, in contrast to the core concept of best available techniques that links emission limit values directly to the economic cost of technologies. And I think there's another fellow that could be addressing this best available techniques. Third, that incineration of waste was strictly not necessary. It can be substituted by desktop-based solution focused on waste management. For example, digital collection and other systems are getting successful results in regarding separate collection, for example. And fourth, that the organizational skills of civil society have shown key for monitoring and limiting the impact of incineration activities based on a variety of legal, health, and environmental arguments. So I certainly recommend you, if you're interested in the, because it was a long report, if you want to have more detail on the case studies or the legal framework, please go to the report. You will find all the information I've been talking through. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sergio. Really interesting to hear again the main findings of this report, which are very relevant to the air pollution agenda, especially seeing these contradictions between the EU policy levels and then World Health Organization levels. It's quite worrying to see that there is a gap there that really needs to be addressed. I'm going to give the floor now to Professor Vyvyan Hauer, and just to remind everyone, we will have time for questions after all the presentations. I'm taking note of questions, and we will have time later. But thanks a lot, and don't hesitate to share your question in the chat. So, Professor Vyvyan Hauer, are you ready? Can you hear us?
Well, I can hear you. Can you hear me? That's
yes, we can hear you. Excellent. Thank you so much. I'm so glad we made it. I'll just give you the floor. The floor is yours.
Thank you. The slides, can you put those up? Good. And I apparently, because I'm on the phone, I have to ask you for to change slides. Okay, so firstly, if we look back at the history of waste, we find that over the past 150 years, it's gradually got more toxic with the introduction of more metals and more synthetics and radionuclides and things. So that now the disposal of waste does present a major toxicological problem. And I'm going to address one side of that today, which is particulate air pollution. Can you take it to the next slide, please? Good. The other thing I want to say in advance is that when I talk about incineration, I also include gasification, because the latest rash of applications for these devices seems to use the term gasification. But to all intents and purposes, the problems remain exactly the same. Okay, next slide, please. Going on about gasification just for a little bit, I don't think that this is a proven technology. It seems to be basically in the experimental stage. Next slide. We have examples where licenses of such plants have been revoked over failure to meet the emission standards required. The Dumfries one next. And this was the Isle of Wight plant. Once again, it was hopeless. It couldn't get anywhere near its emission standards. Next one. And I'll leave people to read that in due course, but it's all pretty well documented. Okay, next slide. Okay, so now this is the main part of what I want to talk about. With incinerator emissions, health problems can be looked upon as local and global. And I'm sure most of the listeners already know a lot about persistent organic pollutants that go long-range transport, etc. So the local problem is really to do with small particles. That's the main bit of it, and that's what I'm going to address now. The next slide, please. Okay, so the main components of this local problem are to do with the standards. The problems are to do with the standards applied to licensing of incinerators. And for particles coming out of incinerators, the regulatory metric is based on mass. And we've known for decades that that's not a very effective approach. Next slide, please. This all goes back to the mid-90s when actually I was the president of the Royal Microscopical Society, and we organized a meeting on ultrafine particles. It was the first meeting to look at the health effects of very small particles, PM.1, and this book was the result. Now, since then, we started to learn a lot more because nanotechnology has emerged, and there's a lot of money being available for studying the health effects of nanoparticles. It's a long march, and we're still learning a lot. But some of the findings of that research are of direct relevance to the public health effects that we see from particles. Next slide. Probably don't need to rehearse this in the present forum, but already PM10 we've had mentioned by the previous speaker, particles of less than 10 microns, these are called coarse particles, and then PM2.5, fine particles, and then these very small particles, ultrafine particles. Now, as the size gets smaller, we find that the harmful effects, the hazard, increases. And I'm going to go into some of the science behind that. Next slide, please. Okay, well, two of the big names in the epidemiology of looking at what happens to particles are Dockery and Pope in America. They organized the six-city study, which was half a million people interviewed by questionnaire. And they found that there was a 15% higher mortality in the most polluted cities. Compared to the least polluted, and of course that evidence was challenged, but meta-analysis has upheld the original study, and then since then we have the study of Kunsley and other people in Europe which support it. So I just extracted two pretty relevant sentences from that research. They can't find a cutoff point for no effect. So regulators always like to look for no effect levels, then they can set a regulatory limit. So Dr. and Pope, supported by others, have found that there isn't a well-defined no effect threshold. Any exposure, as far as we know, is harmful. Next slide. And the other thing they meant, don't bother to read all the sentence, it's quite convoluted, but basically what they're saying is that no research has been done, we're talking about, to look at the comparative toxicology of effluvia coming out of incinerators compared, say, with vehicles or coal power stations. The research could have been done. We've had the tools to do that for probably a couple of decades now, but it hasn't been done. From what we know about the feedstock for waste incinerators, it's very heterogeneous. It contains many different aspects, including lots of heavy metals, things like that. A priori, I would predict that the effluvia coming out of an incinerator might well be more toxic than from vehicle fruit. But we don't know that. It shouldn't be. Next slide, please. Okay, so The work of David Jefferson, who's a crystallographer, on small particles was something which sparked my initial interest. What he found, and what we know, is that when you take matter, which might be quite inert, something like gold or platinum, then you make it into very small particles, it becomes chemically reactive. That indeed is how we make heterogeneous catalysts. And that's because you get disbalances between the number of atoms and the number of electrons. So basically they become charged, and chemistry is all about electrons. So we change the surface chemistry of these matter, of matter, by making it smaller, and then generally we make it much more reactive. And indeed, this is where this research is taking us, is to look at the interaction between the surface chemistry of very small particles and the wet biochemistry which we're made of. Next slide, please. So then it turns out that very small particles can travel around the body, and they use the same mechanisms that are available to viruses. So at the surface of cells, there's a continuous formation of little vacuoles, and this is a process called endocytosis. And the smaller particles in the ultrafine range are small enough to be taken up by this and transmitted across cells, and then exocytosis, they can get into the bloodstream. And it's been demonstrated that these very small particles can get into the brain like that by bypassing the blood-brain barrier, and they get across by the same mechanism. They can get to the heart and all over the place, admittedly in quite low doses, but if that's happening all the time, of course, then you have to think about what the cumulative effect of that might be. Next slide, please. So here's an electron micrograph of some diesel particles. Now you can see the scale bar at the bottom is 10 microns, so PM10 is smaller than that. And you can see there are some quite big lumps of material there. But you can also see that there are myriads of very small bits of matter. And these are the very small particles. They're very much greater in number than the large lumps. And those are the ones which we believe are most dangerous medically. Next. Okay, now this is quite a complicated slide in a way, but it's one that's most relevant. So this is an analysis of the same set of particles by two different approaches. So the dark line, is analyzed by number concentration, and the gray line is analyzed by mass concentration. So I can just unpack that a little bit for you. If you integrate the area under a small part of this curve, say the number concentration, it will tell you the proportion of the total number of particles in the aerosol which have that size. Whereas if you integrate under a bit of the mass concentration curve, it will tell you the proportion of the total mass of the aerosol which has that size. This mass concentration is what is normally used. But the other concentration is the most relevant. So by looking at this slide, what you can see is that the majority of the number of particles is the very small ones. And by comparing it with the mass concentration curve, you can see that they weigh almost nothing. So what we have is that in the upper curve, we have vast numbers of very, very small particles, but the regulatory limit is based on the mass concentration. And what we know from the filters that they can use in incinerators is that they're not bad at suppressing the bigger ones. They can catch those in the cleanup, in the bag filters and things like that. But the very small ones, of course, down at the lower end of this range, they act like gases, they diffuse. And the the abatement devices on incinerators are designed to let gas through. So there's nothing that they can do about it. They are going to produce an aerosol of vast numbers of extremely small particles. Next slide. Okay, well, I don't know whether this is, it is actually animated, so it should drop a particle down into the lung if you press the button. Is that working? Oh, no, okay, go back. The animation is not working. All right, so when a particle goes down into the lung, a lot of them are captured on the surfaces of the bronchi, and then they get onto a sort of mucus carpet, a mucociliary escalator, which makes them back up, and then you swallow them. But some of them get right down into the surface part of the lung and into the air spaces, and then they can't be brought back on the mucociliary escalator, and they tend to get mopped up. This last little square here is macrophages, the scavenger cells that go around mopping up particles, and you can see here the white dots are fluorescent particles that have been mopped up by these scavengers. However, they can easily be overwhelmed by large numbers, and what we've seen in the previous slide is that we are dealing with large numbers. Next slide. And then this is just to give you an idea of size. So down here in the bottom, you can see blood written, and then the white stuff to the left and the right is air. So you can see that there is a membrane there between the blood and the air. It's only about 200 nanometers thick. And so compared to that, we see a PM10 particle, we see a couple of PM1 particles, and then we see an ultrafine particle, PM0.1. And those smallest ones you can see would be able to be taken over by this endocytosis into the blood. Next, please. Next slide, please. All right, so this is the work of Ken Donaldson and others. They, in an experimental setting, instilled carbon black of different sizes into the lung of experimental animals. And the thing to notice is that the very smallest particles, so in the left-hand column you have the size of particles in nanometers, and in the right-hand column you have a measurement which tells you how much inflammation is going on. And you can see that it's inversely related. So the smaller the particle, the more inflammation it induces. And that's the general finding. Next slide, please. Similar work by Donaldson. Here, they were looking at titanium dioxide and latex. And you see that the white column is ultrafine particles, so that's PM0.1, and the black is PM2.5. Now you can see, and this is an measurement of the amount of inflammation. You can see A, didn't seem to matter too much what it was made of. If it was small, it produced more inflammation. And this is, as I say, a general finding. People are still trying to work out what, if any, effect of composition is. But smallness and this increased surface activity, surface chemistry, seems to be the thing that is has a common factor of being able to induce inflammation. Next slide, please. Yet another example from Oberdorf's lab. Here they heated up Teflon, and if you get it up to about 500 degrees, then it forms an aerosol. And the peak on the left is the immediate aerosol that's produced, and then after a while, the particles start to aggregate, and the size distribution moves to the right. They get bigger. Next slide. And the effect of this, as you can see, for the fresh aerosol, is it's highly inflammogenic. I think all the previous animals died in experiments. Whereas once it's aged and got above this ultrafine range, then the ability ability to induce information goes away again. So this is another indication that particle size is a really important factor in health effects. Next slide. Okay, so this is a sort of meta-analysis, really, of a number of studies that have been done on the effects of particle loading in the air on daily mortality in various systems. And you can see that as the concentration of lupus goes up, then the mortality goes up. And that mortality is generally measured in two main areas of disease. So there's an immediate effect, which is on respiratory systems, so respiratory irritation, respiratory failure. And then about 3 or 4 days later, there's a second peak of cardiovascular incidents, strokes, and heart attacks, because that process seems to take longer to come into effect. And actually, you know, most Western health services have their own meteorology service, and indeed we predict the number of beds that will need to be reserved for these events when poor air quality happens. Next slide.
Vyvyan,
as they get smaller,
sorry, Vyvyan, just because I don't have other way to message you, but just to say there's 3 minutes left.
Okay, I've nearly finished. That's all right. Thanks. Yeah. Here's a paper by Chang et al., and they looked at the differential deposition of metals on fine particles. And they found that 80% of these zinc, lead, and copper was found on fine particles, but only 20% on coarse particles, which are much more carbonaceous usually. And the fine particle problem. Yeah, next slide. It's just there's one or two more of these. Next slide. Yeah. Okay. Now here. Go back one. Go back one. Yeah. So this. Cormier paper reaffirms that inhalation of fine and ultrafine particles is a major route of exposure to toxic combustion. So things actually condense on the nuclei of these particles. And okay, now the next slide. And Chow et al. In this paper, they showed that the highest content of dioxins was on particles of less than 2 microns. Up to 80% of the deposited TEQ on particles within the small one. And next slide, which is, I think, probably the last. Yeah, okay, I'm just mentioning this because this is maybe a relevant paper. But in Boras in Sweden, they introduced in 2005 a modern in Finland. And then a bunch of guys at the local university decided to collect. After it started working, they decided to collect particles. They analyzed them by EDXRF, which tells you what they're made of, and then they used principal component analysis to attribute the source of those particles to various processes. Now, it's a preliminary study, this, but I don't think it's ever been reproduced. And they said that somewhere between 19 and 32% of the particles in the air in that city, which is not a major industrial city, had come from the incinerator or other combustion processes, or not including cars. They were in cars, vehicles were in a separate component. But mainly, they thought that this was a massive input. Now, this, of course, was in the number weighted distribution. It wasn't in the mass weighted distribution. So, I think that paper is one that needs to be noted. Next slide. Okay, so I'll stop there. I've got something about persistent chemicals, but the main thing I wanted to address was the particle problem. Small particles can't be stopped by incinerators. Some of them form secondarily after they've left the stack anyway, and there's nothing they can do about it. And those seem to be more toxic in what's deposited on them, and from a medical point of view, those are the ones which the science seems to indicate do the most harm. Okay, we finished. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Professor. That's been really, really interesting to go into such detail on the reality of the nanoparticles, the very small macroparticles. It is definitely important to remember how there is no safe exposure and how much of a deeper impact it can have on our health, these particles, and how actually no technicality, no as much advanced industrial filter can actually deal and stop these particles from being in the atmosphere. Precisely. Now we're going to move on to the next presentation from Krister, and the important thing that he's going to talk about is the EU National Emissions Ceiling Directive. This directive precisely is setting up national targets for EU countries and has introduced as a new element regulations for PM2.5. In our work, Zero Waste Europe, we have mentioned once and again to the European Commission that because of all that Vyvyan has explained, it's important as well to that nanoparticles are addressed, and this remains a gap in European policy. So, but I'm going to give the floor to Krister so he can tell us all the latest about this directive and so yeah, thank you so much. The floor is yours.
Now, hope you can hear me. I'll start anyway. So how do I regulate the two next pictures? There we go. Just to give a brief history of, the NEC directive didn't come from nowhere. It all goes back to the 1960s or 70s when we had the first sites of acidification of ecosystems in Scandinavia and Northeastern America as well, Canada, which led to the formation of the Convention on Long-Range Transboundary Air Pollution. As you can see, I won't read through all these legislative pieces. But that later on moved the EU to adopt an acidification and an ozone strategy in the late 1990s, which was also then turned into, in 2001, to an emissions covering total national emissions. So while there is a lot of sectoral legislation in the EU, which primarily focuses on local or national problem level, pollution levels, the NECD is primarily there to regulate overall emissions in the EU and therefore also to hit the transboundary component. The convention covers all the EU countries plus Eastern European countries plus the USA and Canada. And there's a number of protocols under the convention, and the most important one, of course, in the context of the National Emission Ceilings Directive is the Gothenburg Protocol, called Gothenburg Protocol because it was signed in Gothenburg in 1999, and Gothenburg is where I'm sitting at the moment. It covered then four pollutants, just like the first National Emission Ceilings Directive. It was amended a couple of years ago in 2012, and then PM2.5 was added. So it was the first time you got PM in international legislation. And as a result, or largely as a result of that, PM2.5 is now also in the new version of the National Emission Ceilings Directive. This is to show that air pollution legislation, if you remember the first slide, all these sectoral legislation and some international initiatives actually have given some result, especially when it comes to sulfur emissions, where we've had a 90% reduction since the peak around 1980. Nitrogen oxides, volatile organic compounds have both come down by about 60%, while I can see that the numbers have been moved around a bit here. Ammonia, which is primarily from agriculture and primary particles, PM2.5, has only come down by about 25%, although the data for PM2.5 is much more recent. We only got comprehensive data from most countries from around 2000. There are some countries which have more historic data as well. As a result of these emission reductions, we've also seen improvements in the environment, which was the target initially for these reductions. So you can see that the area where the critical loads for deposition of acid substances have been exceeded over time were increasing all the way up to 1980, and since the sulfur reductions, they have come down tremendously and are projected to continue to decline. Eutrophication, which is linked to an excess of nitrogen deposition to ecosystems, is a much wider problem geographically. The figures you can see on the left side, the percentage refer to the ecosystem area, the natural ecosystem areas in the different countries over Europe. There are some improvements over the last few years as a result of NOx and ammonia reductions, but there's still a long, long way to go. This shows where you have the geographical distribution. I see there's a question about the overhead slides. Yes, they will be made available, and I won't go into all the details of all the slides because there's a lot of detail. Now, there was a big change in the 1990s. By all these initial legislation and initiatives was directed towards protecting natural ecosystems. From about the early 1990s, or most of them at least, more focus at EU level and also at the international level, more widely, was on human health. And that also meant looking more on particles as well, which will be we'll look more on in the next few slides as well. Here's an overview of the current air quality situation in the European Union. Data is from the Europe Environment Agency, so their official monitoring data. And here you can also see the difference between the EU air quality standards, as Sergio was mentioning, and the WHO, World Health Organization, guide values. And especially if you look at the number of people being subject to excess air pollution exposure and compare that with the WHO numbers, which are the most relevant ones, surely if you want to protect health, you can see that more than 90% of the urban population and the majority of people in the EU are living in cities, are exposed to excess PM levels and also excess ozone levels, which of course results in a lot of health impacts. At the bottom, you can see some of the numbers estimated to lead to about 400,000 premature deaths from PM. And this includes both direct primary PM and secondary PM, because much of, or even in some many cases, most of the particles in the air that we inhale and that cause these environmental and health impacts are secondary particles, that is ammonium sulfate and ammonium nitrate, that emanates from the emissions of sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and ammonia. And of course, the further you go down, closer to the emission sources, like down at street levels where you have the exhaust pipes of diesel engines, then the amount or the share of primary PM is getting bigger. There's also about 16,000 premature deaths from ozone and some 70,000 premature deaths from NO2, according to these data. But the health impact is much more than just premature death. So there's a number of diseases and illnesses, medication, hospital days linked to this. And for those who are economically interested, there are of course a lot of costs associated to this. And there's also reduced productivity, lost working days, which is of direct relevance, of course, for economic estimates. Looking at the PM in urban background and in a city, this illustrates, this is a picture from taken from the Institute for International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, which is used as a consultant for the European Commission and prepared most of the background data that was used for the was the first and the second National Emission Ceilings Directive. And as you can see, there's a very big share of the PM in background. Here's for the average for a number of Dutch cities that emanates from international emissions. Even when you go down into a city center, you can see more than half of the PM levels that people are exposed to actually originates from outside the city. So in most cases, most of the pollution, the exposure, is of national or international origin, even at the local level. So what are we heading for? Why do we have this directive? Why do we want to cut emissions? Two major reasons, and they are, you can find them in the EU policy in the 7th Environmental Action Programs. They have been there ever since the 5th Action Program in 1993. And that is to come down to levels that are not harmful for people to breathe. It is to come down to deposition levels and exposure levels for ecosystems and biodiversity that are also harmless. So that's sort of the long-term objective that we're aiming for. And that is why we have all the sectoral and also the NECD legislation. When preparing the revision, the Commission was looking at various ways of closing this gap because from current excess concentrations and depositions down to levels which will no longer be harmful. And you can see here when they were doing this, we didn't have the 7th Environmental Action Program, but the 6th one. That's sort of the long-term target. They couldn't see it was feasible to achieve that by 2020, so they moved the target to 2030. Of course, in the end, as you will see, we will not be able to achieve the target even by 2030 with the current legislation. But this is the principle for how they wanted to analyze the possibility of achieving these long-term objectives. And they did that by doing projections of future emissions and then also future exposure and future depositions of these pollutants. You can see the situation in 2010 when it comes to health and projections up to 2030, what the situation would be like under business as usual. That is, if assuming still that all member states would implement existing legislation properly, you would still have more than 300,000 premature deaths from air pollution. This is more illustrative. You can see emission projections from 2010, which was sort of the current latest data when this review was taking place over the last few years, all the way up to 2050. And the very upper end is the expected reductions from implementation of existing legislation. There are assumptions on future economic growth, future transport growth, future production levels, etc., buried behind here. So that is taken into account. And then the first line here shows you what would be expected by using the best available technology only. So no structural change, but only putting on cleaning equipment on various types of exhaust pipes or chimneys. You can also see the importance of climate policy, which is the red line that would cut emissions significantly in itself for some of these pollutants like SOx and NOx. And then if you add on technical measures on top of that, you would get additional reductions. So that's the potential emission reductions, assuming no major structural change. Of course, if we change the way we deal with, we transport ourselves, and the way we produce energy from fossil to renewables, etc., you could do much bigger reductions. Coming back to the Commission's proposal after a couple of years of preparation, you can see that we have a theoretical baseline in the improvements of impacts to human health and environment. The Commission proposal aimed to reduce, compared to what you could achieve theoretically with technical measures, to reduce that gap by about two-thirds. For 2020, they were not very ambitious at all they would even allow countries higher emissions than what would be expected from just implementing current legislation. Of course, the environmental movement wanted to go longer, as you can see at the very bottom. I won't go into details of all these numbers. This is just so you can look back later on to see for yourself the numbers. But basically, going for the ambition level the Commission proposed would entail these type of additional reductions from 2005 to 2030. It would mean theoretically a cost of about 3.3 billion euros per year for all the EU 28 countries together. But that would in real the return in improved health, less health damage, which were at least 10 times higher, maybe 40, 50 times higher. Here you can see the numbers of the health and environmental improvements from the same proposal. 3.3 million may sound like a lot of money if you break it down on 500 people living in the EU. It's only about 6 euro per person and year. That's what you pay for a couple of coffee when you're out if you're out in a cafeteria. So it's not that burdensome really, if you think. The EU proposal, the Commission's proposal, was updated in a process where they had new and better data. So it was updated in 2015 with data from member states. It was, however, not updated, unfortunately, with the climate, with the new data that came as a result of the climate and energy policy package, which would have made further measures to reduce air pollutant even cheaper and easier to achieve. You can see the final proposal, the final agreement, I should say, at the very right end. So this is what the Council and the Parliament, after a couple of years of negotiation, agreed on the 30th of June just this summer. So methane was cut out. PM, the main target perhaps for our discussions, is supposed to be cut by about 50% from 2005 to 2030. And there are additional reductions also for other pollutants. As you can see, ammonia agriculture is still largely doing very, is still doing very little compared to other sectors of society. Apart from new emission reduction targets, or emission reduction commitments as they are named nowadays, the things that is useful for you to know perhaps is that there is much better requirements now for member states about how to monitor and report their emissions. There is also a better requirement now for member states when it comes to preparing national air pollution control programs. So they must show various types of policy options that they have considered, and they must consult the public when drawing up these plans. And the first national air pollution control program is supposed to be reported in 2019, and then every 4 years there's supposed to be an update, and there's a public consultation involved all the time, so here's an opportunity to get involved. On top of that, there will be a European Clean Air Forum set up by the Commission for consultation with stakeholders and for exchange of best practice. Some of the less good things in the new legislation is more flexibility allowed. I won't go into details on these. They don't have any sort of significant impacts on the detailed level on sectoral emissions like that, but it means countries will have some room for maneuver rather than doing the absolute reductions that we were talking about later on. If you want country by country data on the percentage emission reductions for each pollutant and each country, those are published in the latest issue of Acid News, our magazine. There are some sectors still really escaping or being treated more favorable than other ones, that they have to do less. And they are also more problematic to cover and to get things to really happen on. And those include domestic heating, especially solid fuel, burning and in Eastern Europe also still quite a lot of coal burning. It's the non-performance of the Euro standards for diesel engines that will take still some years to sort out unless we get rid of the diesels totally. There's international shipping, still a big polluter. And there's agriculture, which contributes not only ammonia and methane, but also some emissions of primary particles. The NGO has tried to push this further, and we still continue to do that. There will be an opportunity later on for a review of this directive, but it will probably not take place until around 2024, 25 or something like that. But that would imply we could then strengthen some of these standards, especially in light of the benefits that we get from a stricter climate policy as well. That means we could also strengthen the air policy quite significantly, more or less automatically. We also want to have the EU air quality standards to be aligned with the WHO recommendations. And we want some sector legislation to be better as well. We need to continue to work also through LERN, which is a place where you can also push measures that will to later take place in the EU and also happen outside of the EU. We have neighbor countries which export pollutions to us. IMO is a big power when it comes to regulating emissions from international shipping, and climate policy has a major impact on air pollutant emissions, as I mentioned, so we need to keep track on that and push for decent climate reduction, the climate greenhouse gas reductions as well. In conclusion, we will not meet the environmental objectives set up by the European Union by this directive. It is not enough, not even combined with the existing sectoral legislation. We need to do much more. We know that air pollution control brings significant benefits. You usually see cost-benefit analysis showing benefits to cost ratios of 5 or 10 or even 20 or 40 times. So you get 10, 20, 40 times your money back if you look at it from a society economic point of view. We have some sectors which are still lagging behind where we need to catch up. That include also the combustion plants. I didn't talk about them specifically, but Aliki will talk more about the opportunity to use BAT and the BREF documents as a way of pushing those standards. And finally, I mentioned our magazine Acid News, which I just can recommend to you as a good way of following what's happening on the air quality policy in EU and also to some extent outside of Europe. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Christer. It's great to have your detailed information about the National Emission Ceilings Directive, and I have some questions, but I'll keep them for the end of the presentations, and I'm going to give the floor now to Aliki Kriekouki, who's gonna talk about waste incineration BREF. Aliki, are you ready?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, thank you so much. The floor is yours.
Yes, great. So good afternoon from me as well. For the people that joined a bit later, I must repeat that I work for the European Environmental Bureau, OEB, in the area of industrial policy. Main focus of my work is to follow the implementation of the Industrial Emissions Directive, the reviews of the BREFs, and in particular the waste treatment and the waste incineration BREF. Even though I think it's more important to focus on the waste incineration BREF today, with this presentation, my aim is to give you an overview of what the BREFs are about, why they're so important, how they're being reviewed, including challenges faced by NGOs involved in the process, but also opportunities arising therein that we need to exploit. And we'll finish with more specific information on the waste incineration BREF. So the legislative framework within which the BREFs are developed and reviewed is the Industrial Emissions Directive, or ID. But I think since the first speaker has already given an overview on the ID, it makes sense to skip these few introductory slides to save some time. And what you need to keep in mind is that the development of the BREFs lies at the core of the implementation process of the ID. And the main reason for this is that the conditions of the installation permits have to be based on the best available techniques conclusions, which form part of these reference documents. One of the most important changes brought by the IED is the transition of the legal status of these BAT conclusions. Because under the IPPC directive, which is the predecessor directive of the IED, the BREFs were merely considered as guidance documents. They had no legal status, but now within the IED framework, they are translated into legally binding requirements. Here you can see a definition of the BAT. So best available techniques means the most effective and advanced stage in the development of activities and their methods of operation, which indicates the practical suitability of particular techniques for providing the basis for emission limit values and other permit conditions designed to prevent, and whether it's not practicable to reduce emissions and the impact of the environment as a whole. Best is linked to the means the most effective in achieving a high general level of protection of the environment as a whole, which means that we do not really want to have any adverse and significant cross-media effects when we're implementing a specific technique. So, for example, do not implement technique to reduce air emissions as much as possible while at the same time having significant waste generation. And available links to the technique accessibility by the operator, as well as the implementation of the technique under economically and technically viable conditions. As you can imagine, let's say the ambiguity that is included in these terms gives a great base of debate between our side and the operator side during the review process. And here you can see the definition of the BATILs, which stands for the emission levels that are associated with the application of the best available techniques. Is the range of emission levels obtained under normal operating conditions using a best available technique or a combination of best available techniques expressed as an average over a given period of time under specified reference conditions. Here you see an example of a BAT conclusion, which includes BATILs. So as you can see, it's about the reduction of VOC emissions from a given process X. So it's BATs to use one or a combination of the techniques given below. You have a list of techniques, the description, and any kind of applicability restrictions, which most of the times it applies to the age or the capacity of the installation. And as you see, the BATILs most of the times are expressed in concentrations, and depending on the pollutant, you may have wider or shorter ranges. We as EB, we advocate especially for pollutants that are of high environmental concern, like PPDs, to also have the BATILs expressed as loads, in order to be able to account for the, let's say, for the total environmental impact. In terms specifically of air emissions, the enhanced legal status of the BAT conclusions means that the competent authorities shall set emission limit values that ensure that under normal operating conditions, the emissions do not exceed the BATILs, as the first speaker, I think, already said. Unless, of course, the operator manages to obtain a derogation by the authorities. You also have these cases, because the operator can actually require the ID Article 15.4 derogation, and then if he obtains this derogation, they can deviate from the BATILs. Now, on the review process, the process of the elaboration review of a BREF, or put in other words, the Sevilla process, named after the location of the commission board that coordinates the reviews, It's an information exchange involving all relevant stakeholders. So the technical working group is comprised by representatives of EU member states, of environmental NGOs, with EB being the main active NGO, industry representatives, and the European Commission. The review is quite a lengthy process, so it takes 2 to 3 years. Here you see the main steps. The first step is the reactivation of the technical working group, the submission of initial positions, and then you have a kickoff meeting where all the wishes of different stakeholders will be discussed, and then you will have the plan for the review, the key environmental issues in the context of the review will be defined, and scope issues, or all the important decisions will be taken there at this first meeting. Then you have the data collection, which is based on a collection of information and data from installations, so the real performance data, even though stakeholders can also submit studies or any kind of other contextual information they wish to. Then we have the first draft of the revised BREF, and the technical working group is requested to comment on this. The final meeting, in which meeting you have the adoption of the draft BREF. Next step is the opinion of the IED forum on the draft, which is the political forum that oversees the review of all BREFs. So you have you don't have there necessarily the technical experts, the people that comprise the technical working group, but more the people working at political level, the ministries. And the last step is the comitology vote. The Article 74 committee vote that adopts the BREF, and then you have the publication of the conclusions in the official journal. As I said before, there are a lot of challenges as well as opportunities, of course, linked to the Sevilla process. The first one is the lack of transparency and accountability. Most of the exchange of information is happening behind closed doors. There is an online forum that supports the exchange, because normally you have only two big meetings, the kickoff meeting, the final meeting based in Seville in Spain, but let's say all the interim communications happening in this online forum, which is password protected, which means that if you're not a member of the forum, you cannot really see what's being discussed there, and this prevents the member state representatives to be held accountable for their negative or positive contributions in the review. There's a lack of clear rules for decision making in case of contradicting views, so in many cases, the Commission takes a decision based on arbitrary criteria most of the times. Another challenge is the disproportionate influence of the industry representatives. So to give you an idea, for the waste incineration BREF, it's only the only voices heard from the NGO community is the ones from the EEB. It's we have only one or two people in the best case in representing the NGO community in important meetings, while you have at least 3 or 5 representatives from industry associations, even coming physically in the meeting or having an advisory role. And the last important challenge is also the lack of a conflict of interest policy that allows the industry representatives to be part of member states delegations. So you have operators having the possibility and the ability to be behind member states' flags and lobbying for their own positions. There was a very interesting report that exposed this fact. I thought I put a link there, but I don't see it now. If you're interested, I can of course send it to you, circulate it to you after the webinar. It's called the Smoke and Mirrors Report that exposes, it actually shows the how do you say, shows the composition of the technical working group, the different member state delegations, and the people that are actually sitting behind. So it's very interesting to see the big industry infiltration in the member states delegations. But there are also some technical challenges. It was more, let's say, the previous were more linked to the process itself, more political ones. So we have the lack of concrete definitions, what is a BAT or not. As you see, there were many unclear terms in the definition of best available techniques. Another thing is you have a lack of clear selection criteria for the plans that are participating in the data collection, because the idea is that we need to identify the best performing plans, the state of the art, in order to be able to develop ambitious standards. But this is not the case in reality. We do have, especially for the Western incineration prep, we do have some good plans, but unfortunately, a lot of member states, advised by industry, have overflown the bureau with data also of average performers, and this makes the work a bit more difficult to be able to identify in the huge amount of plants. There are ones that are actually, it makes sense to be involved in the exchange. There is also a lack of clear methodology for derivation of the BATILs, and this is something that it has been criticized. There are some industry voices that also want to have a more clear methodology. This is still an ongoing issue. The Commission said they're willing to put it on the table, as well as the issue of the criteria, but we're still. They haven't set a timeline of this or a context within which it will be discussed. And another important thing is that you have a limited delivery of high-quality plant-specific data that could underpin the adoption of ambitious standards. As you see in both slides, I put two bullet points in red. This was intentional because actually these are the points where we as NGOs can actually really make a good contribution to this process. And this is also an open call for you. As I told you, the EB, especially with the exception of the large combustion plants breath, where we have also interest from other NGOs to join these efforts and to really push the Commission for the adoption of ambitious standards. For the waste incineration breath, the waste treatment breath, or other breaths, let's say we're fighting a bit alone there. So it's not also an open call for you to, first of all, to help to shift a bit the balance, so to have a higher, let's say, a louder NGO voice to counterpart the industry influence, and at the same time to help a bit with the delivery of high quality data coming from the plants that represent the state of the art. This is an exercise that we are currently doing. We have identified some plants that operate in having very low emissions, and we try to get as much information from them as possible, which is a challenging exercise. Because it needs a lot of resources. You also have the language barrier in some countries. So it would be really helpful to also have other people working more on us with, let's say, in finding the data that we want in order to be able to push the Commission to be more more ambitious. So now the Western incineration breath. The Western incineration breath was published in 2006. I put a link there if you want to have a look at it. And you will find the BEAT conclusions in chapter 5. These BAT conclusions, some address the air pollution, some other of them address other environmental issues, because there are also issues when it comes to the pretreatment of the waste, which can also actually place in favor of implementing, pushing the implementation of the waste hierarchy, if some waste can actually be diverted before entering the gate phase of destination plants, or a bit after, before the waste being treated and be diverted to other destinations. You have issues with the treatment of the residues from incineration, and many others. And these BAT conclusions are divided according to the type of waste that's being treated. So you have conclusions for municipal waste, for pre-treated or selected municipal waste, on hazardous waste, sewage sludge, and clinical waste. Here I have, I don't know if you see this very clearly, I have put together the for the same pollutants, the BATILs, which are included in the current BREF, and the the emission limit values that you can find in ID Annex 6. So for you to see that there's a considerable room for improvement there. If you see, for example, for dust, it's obvious you have plants that have achieved to go as low as 1 milligram per cubic meter, whereas the daily average ELV in the ID is set at 10 milligram. The half hourly average is at 30 milligram, which is it's quite high if you compare it to what can be achieved using the best available techniques in the sector. And this, if you see, applies to many of the pollutants. And at with NOx, you also a big difference. If you see the ELVs for NOx, the daily average goes as high as 400, depending on the age and the capacity of an installation, because you have strict you have stricter limits for newer plants or smaller plants, but older plants can be allowed to have this high limit values as far as 400. And while we've seen that by applying the best available techniques, you can go as low as 40 milligrams. So it's we're talking about a factor of 10 of increase. It's really ridiculous. And we have data from plants in Austria equipped with SCR showing that you can have really low NOx emissions. This was just an example. It's just for you to compare and to see that there is really a lot of room for improvement, and this is what we'll try to have during this review. Now for the timeline of the review. Now we're currently at the phase of the we're just before, let's say, the release of the first draft of the revised BREF. So the data collection from the plants has been finished. The bureau the commission is now assessing the data, and at the end of November, for your information, there will be a data assessment webinar where the EB will be represented by myself and two experts working on the issue. The first draft is expected in the first quarter of 2017, and then you can see all the different steps and the provisional dates for your information. Even though you shouldn't really take this for granted, because there's a lot of delays in this process. It can normally take much longer than anticipated. Now, in terms of the, let's say, of what this review is supposed to tackle, and specifically when we're talking about emissions to air, you can see here the slides from the with the conclusions of the kickoff meeting, We must say that we're not, before starting to show to you the conclusions, the Commission had introduced a not very good approach during the kickoff meeting at this step of defining the key environmental issues, which is also a crucial step in the process to define the key environmental issues of its review, which means it's actually, this is important because it's linked to the issues for which BET conclusions will be developed. So once you rule an issue out and you say that, okay, this is not a key environmental issue, it means that you will not have this issue tackled in the BET conclusions. So which means no reference, no possibility, let's say, to have strong arguments and then have inclusions of this issue in the permits of the installations later on in the future. So it's very important also for implementation purposes. So the Commission, what they did is they decided, before having the results of the data collection, to have already an arbitrary categorization for air pollutants. So they said that, as you see now from the first slide, that the key environmental issues in the context of this review, it's NOx, ammonia, mercury and dioxins. So only these four pollutants. Then they said that we have a second category of potential key environmental issues in the context of this review, if demonstrated so by the data collection. And in this category, you have dust and metals, PCBs and PAH, including benzoapyren and CO2 and hydrogen chloride. And we had also a third category, issues not initially considered to be a priority. And there you have the hydrogen fluoride, you have TOC and CO, CO2, methane, nitrous oxide, PM10 and PM2.5, which is a bit ironic thinking that for the categories 2 and 3, first of all, you've seen that there is room for improvement comparing. And we're talking about the BETLs of the current breath, not what is happening now, because, of course, after 10 years, it makes sense that it's logical that you have more techniques applied in the sector, or some emerging techniques have already been deployed. But anyway, and also you see pollutants, like it makes much more sense from an environmental point of view and human health point of view, of course, to address PM10 or PM2.5 rather than total dust. So this was an approach that we reacted upon during the kickoff meeting. Then we pushed the Commission to think about and to review also the criteria behind that underpin this this controversial approach, with the support with some member states as well. And what we obtained the inclusion of some parameters. What you see now is the amended conclusions. So the parameters at the beginning were even fewer. As you said, it was only NOx and ammonia that were proposed as key environmental issues by the Commission to be included in the review. Absolutely unacceptable. In the end, it was also decided to collect data to the questionnaires that were sent in the installations on the pollutants already included included in the annex of the ID. Here you can see the reasons, actually, let's say the rationale that underpinned this arbitrary categorization of pollutants, being the potential of the breath and BET conclusion identified techniques that would further significantly reduce emissions without really defining what significantly means. Which from our case, when we're talking about PBTs, toxic and persistent bicumulative and toxic substances, like the slightest reduction can have a significant impact, of course, to human health and the environment. And the most, let's say, the most worrying thing was that it was clearly said that the WG does not anticipate setting BATLs for those pollutants for which the data collection shows that the BATL would not significantly improve the current level of environmental protection. And we're still, it's still an open issue, though. We're still trying with one of our aims and what we're trying to do at this, right now, doing our own, let's say, on-the-site data collection, is to make sure that we push for the important parameters that are actually included in the BAT conclusions. And since I've seen that I'm running out of time, to give you a bit of an idea of a background of our work, we've been quite active in this breath. We have proposed reference plans for the data collection. We have proposed a push criteria for defining the best performing plans. We have submitted BAT candidates, techniques that could be, let's say, included in the revised specs, in the BAT conclusions section. Apart from this, some technical demands you see them here listed. Some of them is to have a full data collection, and specifically to assess the relevance for benzoapyrene, a really harmful substance, as well as nitrogen oxide and methane, to assess the relevance of emissions from waste incineration plants, to set BATLs, of course, for PCB, PAH. To have BATLs expressed both as short and long-term averages for most points of concern, as well as both concentrations loads, as I have mentioned before. Another very important demand is to have continuous monitoring of mercury and continuous sampling of dioxins, which right now in most installations across Europe, you just monitor mercury dioxins once or twice per year, which for us is really let's say, it's not adequate. And another important thing is to adopt BAT conclusions that would prevent air emissions during the startup and shutdown periods. Because we have many, many plants that have a bypass system, so many times they don't really, all the emissions during the startup and shutdown periods are not being passed through the abatement equipment, but they're just released in the atmosphere, and they can be much more harmful. You have a high emission profile in many plants; they can be much more harmful that and high than emissions during the normal operation. So, if you want to learn more about the EP position and our work on the waste incineration breath, please do not hesitate to keep in touch. I will finish saying that we're also working right now in setting up a website specifically for the breaths to, let's say, to shed a bit of light into this closed-door process and to communicate the concerns of the NGOs more vocally towards the whole NGO community, the decision makers, but also aiming to establish cooperation with technique, with a progressive technique providers that could also come a bit more strongly into the reviews, and in order to have the best possible result. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Aliki. This has been great. Great insight into this process, and definitely useful for us to grow in our awareness of how much the corporate capture of this process and the lack of transparency and is actually impacting this process, and can definitely end up being worsening the impact on health and the environment from these technologies if the regulations are not strengthened. we have just short time now for questions. I've taken note of the questions that people have put forward. I have made two groups of questions, and I will ask the panel to respond. In the first place, Piotr from EEB, he was asking about the legislation that is required. What is the legislation that is required for waste incinerators at the testing stage of the incinerators? What is the legislation that is required to look at the emissions from the testing stage of an incinerator, if any of you know that? There's more questions on emissions. There's more questions on emissions about how are they reported? What should we be looking as campaigners on these plans? From Ivo, and as well, he was asking about the emission modeling and what is the software that is most important when incinerators are calculating these emissions, and how this modeling is working for them to comply with the permit for the EYA. And also Manon, in this similar set of questions, she was asking like, okay, for incinerators, how many pollutants, how many emissions are out of control? Saying in France, we have, there's a number of pollutants that are regulated, but incinerators emit so much more. So it's a question about the gap, how many pollutants are just out there without any regulation. And again, Chris Harmon at the end, he was again asking about how these emissions from incinerators at level are measured. So I don't know if Aliki, perhaps Sergio, that have been looking more at this incineration technology, you have any answers for these questions? And for sure, are you there?
Yes. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you hear me? When it comes to Piotr's question on testing, what I know, I'm referring now to an IED provision. Maybe your first speaker can correct me. In order to enable operators to test emerging techniques that could provide, let's say, for a higher level of environmental performance of the installation, then the competent authority normally grants derogations, temporary derogations, of course, from emission levels associated with the BATILs. So during testing phases, the installations can actually be allowed to emit much more. This is what I know.
And in terms of the gap of the pollutants that are out there that are not regulated, do you have any idea or any estimate of how much there is a gap of air contamination that we don't know, or that we don't know enough, or that policies are really not addressing enough? I don't know if Krister may be able to answer this.
Not when it comes to waste incineration specifically. Probably Aliki knows more about these specific details there. I don't keep track of that detailed level, so I could tell you, because there are quite a lot of pollutants that are listed under the waste incineration and under the emission limit values, but which ones that are left out, I haven't looked into that, sorry.
For us, it's actually, because right now we're also working on collecting more data on pollutants, it's not really clear. When it comes to new pollutants, it's not really clear, I must say, the picture right now.
Okay, so it looks...
One pollutant, I mean, one way of looking at pollutants, which isn't very common yet, is look at particle numbers, as was mentioned also by Vyvyan. The importance of small particles. We have regulation, recent regulation in the EU when it comes to particle numbers from the exhaust pipes of road vehicles, both light duty and heavy duty, I think. But we don't have that for stationary sources yet.
Yeah, okay. Great, thank
Actually,
you.
If
So,
you,
yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. If you compare,
sure.
It's true, but if you compare waste incineration sector to other industrial sectors, let's say at emission EU level or national level, you may not see such a big contribution, but the effect is really, let's say, bad at local level. So maybe it's not, let's say, maybe it's not the parameter to look at the self contributions on for specific pollutants comparing to other sources.
Yeah. Okay. So what about the emission modeling of the software that Ivo was talking about? That's any of you have any insight on that?
From my part, if you refer to the software used by companies, I have to say that the two or three times we tried to have any insight on this issue, it was absolutely not transparent, so it was impossible to know how they what type of software or what kind of models they use for seeing for predicting what is going to happen with pollutants. So I mean, there are a number, 5-6 relevant commercial softwares used for this, but they are they're not transparent. They try not to reveal that the less possible regarding their models and the way they calculate things.
Yes, it seems that every time that we try to see actually what is this pollution coming from incinerators, we are facing lack of transparency and lack of monitoring or insufficient monitoring. So yeah, this is the kind of problems that many people that are here in this webinar as campaigners on waste and air pollution have been facing. But yes, Ivo's question is fair. He's saying, how do we know then that estimates from the EYA are correct then? This is actually, yeah, a question that, do any of you have in the panel have any question for that? How can we trust that the estimates from the environmental impact assessment are correct?
Well, I mean, it depends very much on how much you trust those running the incinerators and the authorities watching, keeping watch over those running the incinerators. The only other option would be to do your own studies and investigations.
Yeah.
There isn't any good answer to this, really.
Yes. Yes, indeed. This is as frustrating as it gets, precisely. Other questions that have been raised from Sue Hoffman. She said, how many years after medical waste incinerator has been shut down does the pollution persist? I don't know if any of you would be able to shed light into this. Like, I suppose it's also one of those estimates. Any of you have any information to share to the panel?
Well, I'm not an expert in any way in the, but dioxins, as far as I know, is very long lived and it will be stored up in the nutrient chain, so it will be there for a long, long time.
Precisely, yeah. This is a question that Vyvyan Hauer definitely will be able to answer. So for Sue Hoffman, make sure that you can send an email to him and he'll be most happy to reply. Yeah, so, and finally, there was also a question about the production of particulate matter as being connected to any kind of burning. So Ivo was asking how we produce heat without any burning. Is this possible, like looking into alternatives and solutions, is it possible that we produce heat without doing any kind of burning? I don't know, the panel would be able to
yes, of course you can. I mean, there is solar heating, there are heat pumps, there is direct electric heating. Of course, that's much nicer. You can provide the electricity by renewable sources. You can have solar panel on your roof. We connect by myself. I have shares in wind power. So there's the number of ways you can produce heat, heat your houses at least without burning. But then the way you can also, there's also of course district heating systems where you, which might be dependent either on waste heat from industry and to some extent at peak powers, perhaps also by burning. But then of course the burning is usually much less toxic than if you have wood burning or coal burning locally. It all gone?
Sorry, Krister. Yeah, didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, but that's fine. Another thing is that where you still want to do local burning for heating, there is current modern technology for wood burning, or rather pellets burning. That is 100 times better from an air pollution point of view than the traditional log wood burning that is mostly taking place, and perhaps 1,000 times better than coal burn, local coal burning.
Yeah, great. Thank you. So just as a final couple of minutes, I'd like to invite the speakers to share a final reflection, maybe around the threats and opportunities that you see in the air pollution agenda, looking at specifically at the waste sector, if you want to share with highlights with the participants in a final round, that'd be great to conclude the event. So any of you want to start, just go ahead.
It might be easier if you tell who should start, but I can start.
Sorry. Yeah, Krister, no, you can go ahead, please. Thank you.
I just read the other day that, was it in Central and South Italy, there are 8 new waste incinerators.
Yes.
I mean, personally, I would have thought with the developments we've had and the thinking that is going on more philosophically about how to deal with waste and try to reduce waste production, the production of waste in the first place, that it would be out of question. But obviously, this is not the case. So this is certainly a threat where you have authorities that think that the best solution to the waste problem is still to build new burners, waste incinerators. So I think it's certainly a big threat. As an opportunity, I see the circular economy, and I think we must push that development to the extent possible and turn it into an advantage from the way we think how society should be managed.
Yes, indeed. Thank you for this. We've been very worried about the news in Italy but yes, it's true that actually in Italy there is a very vibrant zero waste movement with lots of best practices and good experiences in many places that has been fighting really hard to push back on these incinerators. So they're not built yet, and I would guess they might never be built, which that would be the best news for many of us. Please, Aliki or Sergio.
Yes, I would like actually to build on what you and Krister said, that as you said, these plants are planned, have not been built yet. So I think it's very important, apart from implementation, to really work hard on the standards and regulation that would be including the permits of these plants, not to make sure that if they're going to be built in the future, to make sure that it will be as less harmful as possible when it comes to pollution, but also to discourage investments to these plants and to move funding to alternative waste treatment processes, to just to make these plants as expensive as possible, basically. Thank you.
Yeah, precisely. Thank you, Aliki. Sergio?
Yeah, okay, like 3 or 4 main points. The first one would be on the emission side, from the insights registered in the report, there is no point in making companies responsible of controlling and monitoring emissions, because, I mean, they can lie easily. From the emission side, we have to understand as citizens that the EU is assuming an implicit risk, and we are allocating this risk to population living nearby the waste incineration and co-incineration plants. So we are allocating a certain risk, and a specific risk, as Vyvyan said before, nobody is there is no risk-free technologies when it comes to incineration. Experience shows also that fails occur. I mean, technology is not safe at this point, and fails can occur. That you have the gavel in the UK as an example. And finally, I would like to take the opportunity to say that incinerators are not going to help to accomplish with the 2020 and 2030 European targets on waste management. So, I mean, it's not the way. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's been great. We'll have to conclude here. We've actually gone over the time, but it's been really, really interesting. And please, to everyone, thank you for attending. And do not hesitate to send us more questions, more comments, more reflections. We will make all the presentations available, and the recording of this webinar as well will be available to everyone. So thank you very much. We'll leave it here and hope to hear from you and continue working for Europe with good air quality, good waste management, zero waste, and the least incineration possible. Thank you very much to all, and see you soon. Goodbye.